You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
I just want to know when we're rolling. We're not rolling yet, Andy.
I want to do the we're not rolling shtick.
We're going to do the not rolling shtick, but I got to find out when we're actually rolling so I can pretend we're not rolling.
Why don't you guys call me? Hey, I have a better idea. Why don't you call me a half hour before the interview, and then I can sit around while you guys monkey around with the phase shifters.
We're not rolling.
Phase shifters.
We're not rolling yet, right? We're not rolling yet, no.
Okay, so you stop. I wanted to talk to you before we started tape.
Okay. You were over at Michael Richards' house last night, right?
No, I was not at Michael Richards'. I just want to let you know, I got your email last night. I think you're right. I am pleasantly surprised by Trump. I think he's doing a better job than I thought he would do. And I'm going to take all of your arguments under advisement.
Okay, we're not rolling yet, but he did a pretty good job in Russia. I thought he stood up to Putin.
No, we're not. I don't want this to go out. Right?
No, we'll do the other thing. No, but he was great.
But he's a disruptor. He's a disruptor. Finally, we have a disruptor in office.
You.
All right. I'm so tired of this bit that Vaudeville called during his bit.
We're not rolling it, but you said to me you're going to devote the rest of your life to getting rid of the administrative state in Washington.
Let me tell you something. I'm Jewish, which means even though I don't agree with Netanyahu, I back everything he does.
We're not rolling yet, but you believe that the Orthodox Jews should determine the fate of the world, right?
Well, as you know, David, I did an Orthodox Jewish wedding once, and the men were separated from the women, but they both came together to hate what I was talking about. That's a true story, too. True story.
We're not rolling it, but you think Jared Kushner is representative of how all Jews.
If I want to sleep with him while he's talking, if I'm sexually attracted to his dimples, does that make me somehow less of a man?
Makes you more of a man.
Well, that was the weakest bit I think I've ever done.
Well, this is special. We also with us, besides Andy Kindler. By the way, Andy?
Yeah.
We were really rolling.
Oh, my God. How's my acting? No. I just want to tell you that the email that you sent me about how authoritarian dictators under certain circumstances are the best thing for the country, I will read it again.
I'm just saying we need to ease in and out of democracy when time dictates.
That's right. And not all Jews are good. Your point.
And blood diamonds provide work.
Yeah, first of all, is there any blood on the diamonds? What are they whining about what I want to know.
There's blood on the diamonds after I drop to one knee and propose because I'm old.
I want to tell everybody before we begin.
Yes.
That your appearance on the Greg Fitzsimmons show was maybe the funniest thing I've ever heard in my life. And you did a joke that I've been telling everybody only when I shut the phones off. I make sure that there's no way that there are anybody can hear me outside my apartment. But your joke about your was it your father who's a war hero is the funniest thing I have ever heard in my life. I've been telling everybody about it and swearing them to secrecy.
Yeah, my dad was a war hero. He doesn't.
Yeah, what happened?
He doesn't talk about it.
Yeah. Oh, was he? What happened though?
He was in the Japanese theater.
He was?
Yeah, Kabuki.
Oh, that's not the joke. You know the joke I'm talking about?
Yeah, I do.
Okay, we won't do it. We won't. You'll have to go listen to it over there. It's so great.
Well, this has been a stroke of genius. Alex Brazell from Showbiz.
You're not going to include this. You're not going to include the all the stuff leading up, right?
Absolutely not.
We're not wrong.
We edit this. We're not.
So, okay, I'm not going to interrupt anymore. I know was there somewhere, right?
We have a surprise for you, Andy.
Oh, wait. Okay, start it again.
Andy, I just want
I'll
you to know
you
that.
One thing. The last person that I want, I just want to say one thing. I don't have a lot of feuds. Mm-hmm. I don't have a lot of feuds in the business, right?
Right.
But there's one guy, I hate his guts so much. He stole my persona. He stole some of my old. He stole my old joke. Here, New York style pizza. Here's your fucking pizza. He stole that joke from me. He stole some of my I'm half Jewish, half something else jokes. He asked people in the front row what they do for a living, and then they how do you know when they're done? And if he was ever, I can't talk to the guy. I can't talk to the guy. And there's only one person, Joe, and his name is Joe DeVito. So I hope that the surprise is not involved.
Well,
Joe DeVito.
Well, we have a surprise for you, Andy.
What?
Andy's bow tie just spun around when he said that.
Oh, yeah, bow tie. That's because Joe DeVito loves Tucker Carlson. Admit it, Joe.
Andy, I want you to know, when I was figuring out which act I was going to steal, I said, I'm going to go with Andy Kindler's because that act is a rocket to stardom.
You told me long years ago, you said, look, I'm not taking everything you have because I'm not stupid.
So, Andy, I
So what's the surprise? What's the surprise?
I have a surprise. I want you to guess who I have.
Am I sitting down? Am I sitting down?
Stand up. Stand up.
Okay.
Now sit back down.
Now sit down.
Okay.
All right. Are you sitting?
I am sitting down, but I'm sitting on a pointy object. In fact, I'm sitting. I turned a bar stool upside down, and I'm doing a joke in my head about a gay bar.
Seating for four at a gay bar.
Yeah, because in the old days, comics were so funny, they just assumed that gay people would shove any object up their backside.
Didn't you, whenever you played San Francisco, you would pound that stool?
No, I would kick the microphone to Oakland.
Don't drop the microphone in San Francisco is what you're saying.
No, don't drop the microphone because, as you know, the only time gay people get horny is when someone drops an object. And the only sex they like is to surprise a straight person.
So try
this is true. This is a fact. This is a fact. I'm not making it up.
So we have a guest in the studio, and I want you
to... Is it a surprise?
It's a surprise. We didn't want to tell you. Alex,
he's not Italian.
Is he... He's not Italian. He's Italian.
Italian.
And if you're holding a hat, you might want to hold on to it at this point.
Hey, wait a second. My socks are not properly fastened. Mm. Should I fasten them?
Yes.
Or is this surprise? Is this surprise going to knock my socks off?
Do you still have the garters I sent you for your bar mitzvah?
I go down and go. What I do is, I wait 10 minutes and I go, how'd these get in my pants? Boom. Tell me where it doesn't work. It works at the stress factory.
So I want you to guess who we have in the studio. We're going to play 20 questions. We're so excited that we brought him in here because it's just perfect. Mm. It's so
People love 20 questions, Dave, especially these days.
You know what we did? Here's what we did. You know how when you do political satire and you're playing Omaha, the club owner books all the local political satirists, so by the time you get up on stage...
Yeah, I love it.
They're not into political satire. We kind of did that with you. That's the hint I'm giving you.
Oh.
Okay, so we're going to start 20 questions. Who is our mystery guest?
Oh, I'm sorry.
I you broke up. I didn't hear what you said.
We'll clean it up in post.
Who?
All right, I'm ready. Give me okay. a clue.
He is a very funny comedian from Long Island.
Joe DeRosa.
Close. You're very close.
How did I even know the sound of what his name would be like? I'm just sensing it. I'm sensing it.
Here is clue number two, okay? We've got one down, 19 to go. His last name is DeVito.
Oh, I can't believe it. This has been a dream of my life to meet Danny DeVito. And the dream has come. Danny, I loved your work.
No,
I loved your work.
But you're
I did not like your work in Taxi.
You're hot. You're getting there, but you're red hot. Okay.
Should I not be should I not be masturbating during this? You haven't started a tape yet, have you?
No. But this is, we're getting there. This is, you're really good at this game. Okay, two down.
I masturbate into a towel. This is a little known fact about me. During my act.
I heard you're so horny, you masturbate while you're masturbating.
That's true. The only way I can get hot is to think of Joe DeVito. Is that wrong?
I'm sorry.
This is the most anti-gay podcast.
It's pro-gay. It's pro-gay.
Right.
It's pro-gay. Okay.
If you tell me I'm breaking up one more time, I'm going to hang up.
Okay.
I don't know what that means. I'm sorry. That wasn't me.
All right. If the guy from Taxi, who played, was it Louis?
Yes, Louis De Palma was the character.
The Louis De Palma character, the actor's first name was Joe. If his first name was Joe, but he kept his last name, what would his name be? I think he's going to get it on this one.
You know, I got to tell you something. I have to be honest with you. I only watch Louis C.K. projects now. I would watch Horace and Pete. Louis C.K. just released a show where it's Steve Buscemi looking at a shot glass for 45 minutes.
Well, why don't you give? Why don't our mystery guest is going to give you a clue?
Oh, great!
Just so you know, Andy, we've actually stopped rolling and we're currently recording over the first part of this podcast now. We're reusing the tape.
I would love somebody who was so paranoid about wasting digital space. They kept starting again. Let's start again. Take it again.
Okay. Hello, Andy Kindler. You're joining us from Hollywood, right?
Is it?
No, it's David Feldman. But we're going to guess. I'm David Feldman. You're doing the David Feldman show.
It's okay. You're David. Okay, I got it then. You're David Feldman.
Yes, but we have a mystery guest that we brought in.
Oh, God. This is, you know, you should submit this to worst premises of all time.
Should I throw the cards over panel? Are you stumped?
Throw the cards over. No one even knows what that means. This is literally one lady in Vermont who knows what turn over all the cards.
And she can't hear us.
And she hated that bit. Yeah. She always hated that bit.
She's actually listening to Joe Rogan right now.
I'm listening to Joe Rogan. You think I would listen to this crap?
Well, Sam Harris is over here for breakfast. And he's going to...
All right,
turn me around.
It's Joe DeVito, but I want to tell you something before you talk to Joe, okay?
Oh, we're not rolling. Then.
We're not rolling. No, this is the absolute truth. There is this beautiful video from Africa of a baby elephant. Have you seen this?
No.
No. But do I have to be Bud Abbott during your... No, what's in the back? It sounds intriguing.
I'm trying to tell you. I'm trying. So, no, this is just a true story, and I know the punchline. I want to see if Andy can guess the punchline.
Okay.
But this is an actual video that my sister sent me of a baby elephant that fell down a well in Africa.
Right.
And the mother was freaking out, and you start crying when you watch the video. These African people who protect, what do you call it? Game preserve people.
Okay.
I don't know, but I never heard you sound like you were going to say something crazy.
They distracted the mother elephant.
Okay.
They drove her off this area so that they can go rescue the baby elephant. And then
right.
And it's you cannot watch this without breaking down and crying, because they put the baby elephant back up on its feet and the mother comes running towards the baby elephant. And my sister showed this to me and I thought of the old joke. What does the mother say?
What, and give up show business? Oh, what does she say? The mother says, he had a hat.
I love you. I love you. Thank you.
He had a hat.
My sister fell off. I called her. I said, he had a hat. It's such a great joke.
That is the greatest joke. And the only thing that is incorrect about that premise is the idea of a Jewish elephant.
Well, they have long trunks. Yeah. Those are big noses.
They also don't forget things.
Uh-huh.
They've also suffered as a species.
They're endangered. Yeah, you're right.
They're endangered.
They control show business.
They have to walk around the tent and look. Hey, you know why Ringling Brothers went out of business? They waited too long to talk about the elephant in the room. Am I right? Am I right?
Get back to how elephants are like the Jews, please.
Elephants are like the Jews because, you know, they don't mind walking around in a circle for as long as it's followed by the ice capades. Jews hate circuses. I'm just speaking for myself now.
Why is that?
It smells, it's a thing, and the peanuts, and the, is it that really, are the acts that great?
Mm-hmm.
With the clown and the car and the, hey, you seen one trapeze act.
Remember you, Andy, your mother and I, and you went to the circus when we were kids, and we saw the lion tamer, and your mother said, that's a nice chair. I don't like the whip, but the chair he's holding, that would look good in our foyer. Do you remember your mother said that to us?
Yeah, I never forget that my mother was a stereotypical Jew who would say, I like the chair. I like the chair. Oh, don't touch those peanuts. It's poison. It's poison. Have the whole... You know what my grandmother used to go? Why are you going out to have ice cream? I have ice milk in the freezer. Ice milk. Hey, how can we bring... Hey, let's bring coffee down a notch. Make it ice milk.
When did you first meet Joe DeVito?
I first met Joe DeVito. Now, that is an interesting question because I don't remember. Was it an Omnipop gathering?
No, it was at Montreal. In 2006, Bruce introduced us. I know, right? Can you believe it's that long ago?
And we got along famously.
Absolutely. Or in our case, not really famously.
Almost famously.
we got along
in a niche-like way.
I never should use that word. Yeah.
We got along a margins of show businessly kind of way.
Hey, we got along in a very lucrative way. We got along in a we're both doing great financially way.
You met him in Montreal. Was it
kind
of like Mick Jagger seeing Bianca Jagger and falling in love with himself? Was it a narcissist kind of thing? Were you looking into the pond and seeing your reflection and falling in love with yourself, Andy?
Well, I didn't get any of those references, but let me tell you what it was.
Because there are some
there was a sexual relationship for a couple of years first before we got friendly.
Yeah.
Get it? More gay material.
What did he drop?
No, I knew Joe. The first second I knew Joe.
Well, I want to know what he dropped in order you can't have a sexual relationship.
What happened was.
Whose name did he drop?
This is unbelievable. We were both taking a shower naked together, but I still didn't trust that he wanted to sleep with me, so I threw the conditioner on the floor. And then I attacked him. He threw out his back. His back has never been the same. That's why you saw him at the Sarno funeral earlier this week. Sarno! Nothing?
Who was Sarno?
What?
Sarno was a guy who was a pioneer in helping people with their back problems. He helped Howard Stern.
Right. He says that all back pain comes from my mother.
Specifically, yes. That's right. Everyone tells me to read that book, but I read the first couple pages and thought, this seems close to bullshit.
You know what? This is
true.
No,
it does work. It actually does work, because I know people actually cured their back from it.
Yeah.
But it doesn't work in all cases. Hmm.
I was a pallbearer at the funeral, threw my fucking back out. And I'm telling you, it had nothing to do with my mother and anxiety. I threw my back out. He was a heavy man.
That would be a great visual of all the people at his funeral, you know, holding their lower back at one point. Oh!
They keep having to put the coffin down, take little breaks. Lift with your legs. Lift with your legs.
Bend your knees.
Lift with your legs. He said, "Lift." That was one of the things that he was. He was different about. He said, "Lift with your back." That was, oh my god!
Yeah.
I wish I could have exited. You ever wish you could exit out of every joke that you're telling? That's me. Join the club.
How old was it when he passed away?
What am I? What am I? Wiki Angela? What am I? What am I? What's it called when you're an insurance person? What am I? An actuary now? All of a sudden.
What did he die of?
Do you know actuaries never use the word actually? It's just a thing. Oh my god! This is the word.
Hang on. Actually, I've looked this up. The odds of an actuary using the word actually. are 5 million to 1. That's been figured out.
This is the kind of humor, if all the accountant jokes were out of town, we would switch to actuary humor.
I'm picturing the audience for this particular show. It's like a pyramid that's getting smaller and pointier as you move towards the top. As more and more normal people are dropping off, it's going to focus to a laser point at the end.
Well, that's the thing, Joe. I decided to go older with my demographic, and because no one's going that way. So I have people who brush their teeth with Murder, She Wrote toothpaste. I have people who love Matlock jokes. Mm. Matlock, more like Matt Unlocked.
The Murder, She Wrote toothpaste, that was popular in the early 80s. I used to brush my teeth with that.
Well, you were a big fan of Topol, right? Isn't that what you used?
The
smoker's tooth polish?
Or the actor, the character actor.
I loved Pearl Drops in Fiddler on the Roof. I thought she was brilliant. She played Topol.
Well, Joe brings up a good point, because as you know, Topol was the first person who had a tooth polish named after him. Oh, God, that was weak.
Yeah, it was called Rembrandt, though. They named Rembrandt after Topol. That was...
Do you think if Rembrandt came back alive that he'd be thrilled there was a teeth whitening system named after him?
No, because...
The great Rembrandt.
Because all his paintings were dark. If you're going to name... It should be a tooth-darkening toothpaste.
You know, I think if you told that to him, he would have said that's one of his lesser achievements. Now, the Van Gogh toothpaste is fantastic.
It creates crevices and you can...
You probably haven't heard about it, though.
I have to tell you one thing, though, and this is not
funny.
I
heard half about it.
This is not a funny joke, but I watched...
Please, go ahead. Wait.
Don't let that stop you.
Yeah, hang on. You don't have a joke that's funny? Let's try that.
Are you sitting down?
No, should I sit down?
Van Gogh probably was murdered, is what this documentary showed.
Really?
Yeah, because he wouldn't have brought a gun out 4 miles into the field, and it's pretty an interesting documentary. But you know what? What's not interesting is my retelling of it.
I don't understand how it was possible for his brother to be the guy from The Cosby Show, Theo. He had a brother named Theo.
I can't even believe that there's nobody in the world who would try to make that connection. That's a connection that once you figure it out, you actually get more depressed. Have you seen this Cosby Show? It just came out on DVD. I got to tell you, folks, the brother Theo, who knew that his brother had the same name as Vincent Van Gogh's brother? Who knew?
Did you see this?
Have you seen this? Have you heard about this? You know, I can't watch the old Cosby episodes now as if I would continue to watch it. Yeah.
Before, well, you know, what's interesting is that Van Gogh's brother Theo was a dentist. Did you know that?
No, I just knew that he got murdered, but I didn't know that he was a dentist.
And dentists, jump in here anytime you want. Dentists use laughing gas and anesthesia to put people to sleep. So I'm starting to think that if we spend the next 10 minutes working on this, we can do a Cosby joke.
Now, when you said jump in anytime, does that include 5 minutes before that started?
Could I jump in with a time machine?
Maybe a butterfly
go back
effect?
Before you told the joke?
Joe DeVito.
Yes, sir.
If you could get into a time machine, and Andy and I invented a time machine.
Okay.
But the way it works is it's based on the price of milk. You don't pick the year. You say milk, and you say like 50 cents, and we'll send you back.
Oh.
To when milk was 50 cents.
Okay.
Don't drop the keys in the time machine. That's all I'm telling you. Yeah.
It took me back to the Stonewall riots.
Stonewall riots? How come there are no funny triangle shirt factory bits? So the guy goes back the next day. He goes, look, I know this is a bad time, but I did drop my suit off here yesterday.
The shirtwaist factory.
Oh, what did I call it?
Well, that was
super dry cleaners.
My grandfather owned the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory.
And he said, you're all getting propaganda.
It's not as bad as it looks.
Not as bad as it looks.
He said, ladies, take a half day.
Back then, they thought the worst thing to do would be to leave a fire.
He said to them, when you open the window to jump, bend your knees. You can hurt your back opening the window.
Well, what now, about... see, the night of the tragedy, this wouldn't be funny.
No.
But now...
it's funny.
It's almost there. A little bit more time as the bit ripens.
Oh, man. It's like listening to a mirror when I hear Joe DeVito. It's a, it's like who I could have been. Who I could have been if I hadn't... messed up my career my own way. Mm.
Joe DeVito, if you could get into Andy Kindler's time machine, where would you go?
Now it's branded?
Yes.
It's branded? I guess I would go back to Andy's Young Comedian special and be extra nice to all the other comics to plant the seeds for future work or just a float, a cash loan of some type.
Yeah, I should have done. There's so many moves. I'm going to write a book about all them. It's called What Might Have Been. If I had been nice to Jay Leno and said, you know what, I like what you're doing. If I should have looked at the positive side of show business and celebrated it. Like Wham. I could have been Wham.
Didn't you pitch Jay Leno's garage, but it was just he would keep the Dusendorf going?
Oh, no. What I said? You keep the what?
He would keep the cars going with the doors shut.
Yeah.
Wasn't that your idea for
days? I asked him, can we do a carbon monoxide contest? That's what I said. And then I just left the garage and fell asleep.
Right. I think I said Dusendorf. I meant Dusenberg.
I think it's – what's the difference between Dusendorf and Dusenberg?
Dusendorf is a town. Dusenberg – is a car. Isn't Dusenberg?
It is not a car.
A Dusenberg is a car.
I think you're referring to the do's and don'ts column, usually, right across from the Goofus and Gallant cartoon strip.
No, I was the guy in Germany who said, change your name to make it more Jewish. You're Dusseldorf? Do yourself a favor. Change your name to Dusselberg. and then walk around town and go, what are these yellow stars everyone's wearing? What's going on? Are they mad at the Jews again? I don't like that one bit at all.
Didn't your uncle work the cabarets in Germany in the 30s, and he used to say... Well, go ahead.
No, no, go ahead.
No, he used to say, I'm wearing a yellow star. I should probably wear a brown tie to match my... wasn't that his whole bit?
That's his whole thing. Yeah. That is his whole, I was the one who said in 1937... Hey, come on, give me a break. Someone's got to play the Jew in these propaganda films. Now, that's from my act, folks. That's actually from my act. Someone, get off my back. Somebody has to play the Jew.
Better it should go to one of us.
It should be realistic.
Oh, my God. God, what year would you have gotten out?
So my whole thing is that I would have gotten out like at any, like 1926. If my grandmother goes, boy, Berlin's getting colder this year. That's right. Let's get out. Berlin's too cold. Let's go. Everybody out. I would not have stayed. I hope I wouldn't have stayed. But I'm thinking about that now. I might leave this country now if things heat up.
But didn't your grandmother say we're going to stay and work within the system?
She said, look, don't annoy them, what she said. If you do your job at the camp, you just don't. The problem is there's troublemakers. Don't be a troublemaker. Hey, David, have you heard this joke about the guys who wanted to kill? I love this joke. These are Jewish guys. They get together, they decide to kill Hitler, so they follow along his schedule, and they know he goes for strudel every day at this place. So they wait there, and an hour is gone, he's not there. An hour later, then they finally go, gee, I hope nothing bad has happened to him.
Andy, what percentage of your act would you say is Hitler-related at this point?
It used to be... It used to be like 3/4, but now I've. I told myself years ago I wasn't going to do Hitler jokes. No, I never said that to me. I'm lying. But I thought I would not rely on my Judaism as a crutch. But I actually have a motorized wheelchair.
Well, the last time we worked together, which I guess was 2 years ago, for the second show, I actually requested the downfall bit, and you acted like you didn't know what I was talking about. The 40-minute bit you did about the end of Hitler's Days movie, which
yeah, if I had punched up that downfall movie, I would have had one scene where I have a guy go in there and go, "Hey, I just come back from Hitler's bunker. Has he been acting strange? Does he seem angry to you?" Classics. These are classics.
Good stuff.
Do you,
Dave? Yes? Dave, you're the host, Dave.
No, I'm just. I'm dropping the ball. You know who didn't drop the ball was Hitler. He only dropped one, but
that's right.
He had one testicle.
I don't know if that's true. Is that true though, or is that one of those apocryphal stories?
No, it's true, because my mother was a courtesan during...
Because my mother dated Hitler.
She dated Hitler. Mm.
And they broke up because she tried to make him feel better about his one ball, but there was no comforting that guy.
She said, you know how he got ready for work every morning?
What's that?
Spectacles, testicle, wallet, and watch. Spectacles.
He's not Colonel Clank.
Spectacles, testicle, wallet, and
I
watch.
Thought you were going to say he put his pants on both legs at a time, encumbered by an extra testicle.
No, my grandfather was his tailor, and he said, Mein Führer, which side do you dress? When he was doing the end scene?
I don't even get it. What does that mean, which side? Oh, you haven't finished it yet, right?
You know, when you're measuring for the end scene, they like to know which side of your... Which leg?
Oh, where it hangs.
Where it
hangs. Where do your balls hang?
Where do your balls...
I mean, but you tried to spruce up my political humor, right?
But, you know, I want you to remember that Eva Braun... She had a stroke and could only open one half of her mouth.
Is that true?
Yeah. Hmm. Which was good, because then when he teabagged her, she could accommodate his one ball.
Wow.
Joe, pick up the pace here. Come on.
I'll tell you something about Eva Braun. I think that says a lot about marriage, that Hitler waited until the last possible moment to say, I do. Now step out into the garden with me. You've made me so happy, and I'll make sure they burn our bodies so the Russians don't parade us. Now help me give my dog a pill. Do you think when he poisoned his pets, he wrapped it in bacon?
Only if they were Jewish.
They had an insult.
Well, you know, you said, David Feldman, you said that a stroke of good luck that she had experienced. The stroke of good luck she experienced was the day she hooked up with Adolf Hitler, am I right? Because her mother said, look, Kaiser Wilhelm has a son. He's really handsome. He's going places. My Kaiser Wilhelm jokes aren't going over the grade now. Wonderful. Wonderful. Hey, sorry, Franz Duke. Sorry, Duke Franz Ferdinand. Hey, let me make this guy feel at home. Shoot him. He's Franz Ferdinand.
Is there any coffee? Because I think I could have... Is it possible to have a cup of coffee?
Oh, I think you should definitely slow the show down even further by preparing beverages. You need to
drink at timing. I would love a cup of coffee because I know I could make the show so much better if I could get it.
But you're not going to have a Keurig, right? Now, Joe, are you a coffee snob like me?
No, I don't drink coffee, but I do have the sugar-free Red Bull. I know you used to drink the regular Red Bulls.
Oh, my God. That is the worst. You know, they had a meeting at Red Bull a couple months ago, and they said, you know what we should – does anybody have any ideas? Yeah, why don't we add some flavor to some of the drinks?
The sugar-free Red Bull, imagine if you were to just try and taste the entire can the whole time you're drinking it. It has that it's like you put it in your mouth and wait for it to dissolve like a lozenge. It's the most awful metallic. But I love it. It's a great way to start the day.
I have a lot of Red Bull jokes. I say, are you looking for a beverage where your first instinct is to spit it up? Do you want an energy drink where a half hour later you decide whether you should go to the emergency room? Are you tired of refreshing beverages?
Do you remember we worked St. Louis together, Andy, and we had to wake up to do morning radio? And we got
When Tom Clyde was over there?
Yeah.
When the Squad Brothers came up and introduced?
And Bob Costas was there, too.
Why do you bring Bob Costas out of there?
Because he lived in St. Louis with his wife before they got a divorce. And I woke up to do Stephen D.C. Remember Stephen D.C. from St. Louis?
I don't even remember this. We woke up, were we sleeping together? We were in the condo?
Well, you had dropped the soap, so I just got into bed with you and said, have at it. But I remember this. This is a true story, Joe DeVito. Uh-huh. Andy Kindler and I were co-middling at Catch a Rising Star. And we had to wake up and do morning radio. And we were exhausted. And Andy bought a five-hour energy shot. Mm. And 3 hours into it, he got sleepy, and he went back to the gasoline station where he purchased it. He got his money back. He said, it's a true story. He says, this five-hour energy shot only lasted 3 hours. Look at me. I'm groggy.
Oh, God. And they actually gave you the money back?
They did.
I like the part where I went back to the gas station. where I bought it.
I wonder how many returns they get at that gas station. People unsat. This beef jerky was subpar. I want prorated money back.
I'm like, look at my cock. This tiger pill isn't working.
You call this real rhinoceros horn? This is bullshit. I'm barely having chest pains.
I'm glad we're not rolling because I love that look in my cockpit.
It got a little blue.
I love it. I love it so much. This what do you call it? A tiger pill? I love that.
Whenever I'm traveling, I always go into the gas station to pay. Mm-hmm. And I look around, and they always have interesting pills.
Yeah, great gray market items.
They always work for me.
Yeah.
Things to keep me awake, things to keep me hard. Just take these pills, and I get on my way. And Ron White CDs.
Is that the trifecta of things to keep you erect and alert?
I love the big sugar, the big energy drinks that imply on the outside that you might get killed drinking it.
Andy did a bit. This was before you were born, Joe. Mm-hmm. He used to say, I've tried this new energy shot. Maybe you've heard of it. It's called cocaine.
You know, I tried cocaine. Like, get the bottle up my nose. Couldn't get the bottle up my nose. That was during the period where people would mix up cocaine with the beverage Coca-Cola.
Interesting.
Now, Andy Kindler, this is true. This is the worst. This is why he was banned from The Tonight Show.
Don't tell this story.
No, it's embarrassing, but you know, everybody thinks he's so politically correct. He said, I went to a Coke party. This was back in the 70s. Mm-hmm. He said, I went to a Coke party, and Johnny Yoon went pee-pee in my Coke.
Oh, my God. He was unbelievable. Johnny Yoon was a Korean comedian who worked the Comedy Store. He's not even Chinese.
I know.
Where the joke was derived from.
Me Korean, me tell joke.
Mm-hmm.
Me go pee-pee in Andy Kindler's Coke. And then you put your buck teeth in, and that was it. Do you remember this, Andy?
Mickey, I'm telling you, I still can't stop watching Mickey Rooney and Breakfast at Tiffany's. I mean, I don't know what's wrong. It's so politically correct these days. You can't make your face look hideous and walk around going, oh, saw, 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 saw. These days you can't go, oh, saw.
Thank you. By the way, I just got some Coke, some Showbiz Studio Coke, coffee.
Some Coke.
Andy, Federer's up two sets and a break.
I'm taping the show, you son of a bitch.
Thank you. I'm drinking from a Showbiz Studio mug. Mm. And Joe, did you know that Andy was the first one to say, I like my coffee the way I like my
ladies?
My ladies?
Yeah. He implied that there was some sort of racial component to it.
By the way, Tommy Sledge was hilarious. I don't know where he is.
Oh, I remember that joke. It was the best one. You're absolutely right. Mike Farrow. He had the best one.
Oh, that's his name. I forgot. I always called him Tommy Sledge.
You're absolutely right. Mike Farrow had the single best, I like my women the way I like my coffee. Do you remember it?
Tell him. Yeah, you do it, David.
With big tits.
That's good.
So good.
Oh, I love you, Andy. I love you for remembering that. Isn't that the best?
It's the greatest. We go back so far that we actually predated all of this stuff.
Speaking of predating, before you go out with a woman, Andy, you have a segment producer do a predate, right, to go over the sexual positions, the material. Right.
Well, you know, there was this comic, David, you would love this. His name was George Hamadi, and he was so funny. And one of his jokes was, I know I've been a comic too long, because when I introduced my girlfriend to my parents, I said to her, what do you want me to say about you?
That's perfect.
Isn't that good?
That's great.
That's good. Now you guys have to do. You have to do a show without a part of a show without me. Probably.
I know, but you know, when I did the Tonight Show, Jeff Garlin and I drove to the Tonight Show to do it. Right.
Right.
And I rolled down. There's these gates, right? And there was a guard. There was a guard at the gate.
Right.
And I said, "Hi, we're the comics." You don't get that. It's a true story. I did do
that. Oh my God. How come I don't get that? Because I'm always waiting with your jokes. I'm always waiting. I always say to myself, this can't be it.
This is...
Explain that joke to... Does anybody else in the studio get that joke?
Yeah, I don't get it.
It's a great joke. I did it for Garland and he lost it. And the guy, even the guy in front of the gates got it. I was doing the Tonight Show. I rolled down the window. I said, "Hi, we're the comics." Two comics are on their way to a gig. They hit heavy fog. They crash into a truck. They die. The two of them are walking on the clouds. They see St. Peter and the gates, and they say, "Hi, we're the comics."
All right, well, that makes sense. But that one I like, but the point is that if you go into a studio, they do always ask who you are, don't they?
Yeah, but this guy, well, first of all, his name, the guard, his name was Saint Peter.
I left that
out. And the gates were pearly.
Do you remember when George Hamilton went to the wrong studio in Modern Romance?
Maybe.
I'm sorry. I know every line from the movie Modern Romance. Mm.
You're talking about the Albert Brooks movie.
The Albert Brooks movie, and there's a story where James Brooks tells George Kennedy, "Tell that story about you going to the wrong
Say
studio.
Anything. It's not Modern Romance. It's Say Anything.
It is. No, it's not. Hey, you can't fool me with this.
The James Brooks, the Jilly Kavner movie.
No, I'm talking about when James Brooks was the director in Modern Romance.
You're talking.
Oh my God! None of this will make it to the air, right? Mm.
No, you're talking about that great movie with Nick Nolte.
No.
And Julie Kavner. That was originally going to be a musical. And they took the music out. It's one of my favorite movies. But that's Say
Anything. What's it called?
It's like something like Say Anything. It's where Nick Nolte goes.
Well, Say Anything is a John Cusack movie.
Say Anything is Cusack.
Yeah. God, if only one had some sort of printed guide to VHS movies that we could consult.
This will actually be, you know, it's hard. They say you can't make fun of dementia, Joe, but this will be one of the funnier making fun of dementia. Is me and David trying to remember. You remember this movie with Roy Rogers? Who's smoking? I can hear someone smoking there. What are you smoking over there?
The great thing about Andy Kindler and dementia is all his references will become obscure. So people
even more so.
Yeah, so everybody can enjoy the act if he's playing a nursing home.
You had a great senile chunk. Remember that?
Yes,
Dave?
I do. I wish I could remember it.
I wish something else besides my arteries would get hard.
I have gotten so old. I need. Go ahead.
No, I wasn't going to do how old. Go ahead.
When I have a conversation with somebody, behind them stands a man with bullet points.
I'm laughing now just out of nervousness.
Well, we have let's plug Thought Spiral, which is my favorite new podcast. Have you heard it?
Alex would have a heart attack. If you didn't do it, Alex goes, "Hey, why didn't you plug it?" "Hey, Andy, have you thought about giving up the rest of your career to concentrate on plugging Thought Spiral?"
That sounds exactly the way.
Yeah, it's a dead on Alex. Kindler, it's Alex. Can you call into the show? David Feldman's having a nervous breakdown. If you don't call in, we got nothing. Can you do it, Andy? Can you do, please? I asked you about doing a caller ID. We're saying, "Hey, I'm Andy Kindler. You're listening to Feldman. Can you just do that?"
How has your life changed since the podcast? now that you're in this exclusive club of podcasts.
Oh, well, I draw so much more in the clubs. Is that what's supposed to happen?
Andy, I've heard you started performing at clubs and colleges. Is there any truth to that?
That's right. And colleges.
Andy.
No, I can't perform colleges anymore, Joe. You know I can't.
You're too edgy.
It's triggering. You walk on the thing, they go, you're triggering me. I stepped on this one student's foot by mistake, and they go, it's triggering me.
Have you dropped the gay French king bit? You still doing that? No.
Who are these people who operate their phones and all of a sudden they turn to a gay French king? Oh, hello. I'd like to have sex with men. I'm French. Voulez-vous?
Coucher. Avec quoi?
Avec quoi? Now, people won't know the reference. They're going to have to dig back into the time machine to know what we're talking about.
Let's go back in the time machine.
To many levels.
Milk was 25 cents a gallon. Mm. Voulez-vous coucher avec quoi?
Avec moi. That's moi? Lady Marmalade.
Lady Marmalade.
Patti LaBelle? Patti LaBelle.
Was Patty...
Voulez-vous coucher avec moi? I don't know where you guys are going.
Was Lady Marmalade?
That's the name of the song.
And what
is it really?
Yeah. I think it was LaBelle.
Oh, Patti LaBelle.
I think so. And then it was remade probably 15 years ago with Pink and Christina Aguilera and Maya. And I think Missy Elliott was in the video.
Hmm. Now, Joe, I bet you're like me. I actually enjoy I enjoyed disco when it came out. Did you?
Well, I was a little young
for it. Too young. Right.
I kind of like it more now, but I was always a rock and roll guy. So to me, also, disco seemed to be good-looking people dancing, which I knew was never going to be my scene.
But then That's true.
But then I realized now they're all coked up.
I liked it because of all the coke I was on. Yeah. That's the only reason why I liked it. It's a joke, folks. It's a joke.
Before you go.
That's the worst. That is the most passive-aggressive thing I've ever heard in my life.
Andy, we're going to let you get back to whatever it was you were doing before.
I'm just sitting on the couch, fellas.
I got all day.
I would keep you here forever. You know that.
Joe, it's very important that Joe plugs his new comedy boot camp with Kyle Cease.
Andy, if I was running a comedy boot camp, it would end like a Full Metal Jacket. You'd learn punchlines, and then you'd be savagely beaten by your dorm mates with soap. And then you would drop the soap, and then hilarity would ensue as you were raped in series by your peers.
All right, I'm going to let you guys go because you know what? There's no way that the rest of the podcast can live up to this laugh a second opening, right?
I enjoyed it. Do you have any questions for Andy, Joe? I know this is a big thing for you.
When are you coming back east?
I will be coming back east in September for a funeral. And that literally was unintentionally the worst thing I've ever said.
Yeah. Quick question, Andy. Who books that? Do you have an email?
You've got
a funeral scheduled in September.
Oh, and then I'm visiting my aunt in a nursing home in January. No, I don't know when I'm coming in because I used to be – I said, why did I used to come in? And then I hear Letterman's off the air now. And so –
Oh, yeah. They didn't tell you.
I miss you. When are you coming out here, Joe DeVito?
I don't know. I would like to. I should probably come out there just to see – because I'm not pitching anything. That's the problem.
Tell them the idea.
Oh, we did have an idea last week. It's a cartoon with the bonobo monkeys, and I'm the one who can't get laid.
How come I don't know? I don't know that. I don't even know that reference. What's a bonobo monkey?
The bonobo monkeys are the ones that only communicate with each other through sex. And while the rest of the monkeys are having an orgy, I'm on the outside thinking, looking for something a little bit more substantial. I'm not looking for apes with benefits.
I love this. This would be – you remember how well the cavemen did on TV?
Yes. the guy cocaine. Yeah.
We're back. We're back then. All right, guys. I know you can't for something real. We're all Jews except for Joe, so we can't say goodbye. Is that the problem?
Let's do the Italian goodbye. Oh, God.
He got me in the shoulder.
Then you're stuffed in the trunk of a car as I steal your watch.
That was Andy's closer, actually, for 5 years. Different ethnicities goodbyes.
Yeah.
The Polish... No, I used to do the Japanese movies where you can't hear. What are they saying in those Japanese movies? When they're dubbed? Oh, I will kill you.
Now, let's do your old bit that you used to... Okay, the Polish goodbye. Hello. That's what he closed with.
That's good stuff.
No, I used to close with, I go home, I see my best friend in bed with my wife, and I say, Eddie, I have to, but you? You know what? My dad's funeral, Dave, my mother turned to me. She turned to me, my dad's funeral, and she goes, Andy, I have to, but you?
I was at your dad's funeral, and your mother turned to me and said, my agent was here?
Because you're Jewish, right?
Did you open or did you middle?
My brother was afraid to follow me.
Well, you did that thing with the DJ bit. Hit it, DJ, and then you did the lip-syncing and all that. It's tough.
Andy and I did an Orthodox Jewish wedding together.
And what happened?
And we told the story about the Jewish mother and the son gets washed away by a wave.
Right.
Please, God, please. Go ahead.
No, you do it.
Do the punchline. You're Jewish.
So he says, look, my son, oh, my God, he finds the lifeguard. My son has been taken away by the wave, and I pray to God, if you just deliver my son back to me, I will never complain again, God. And then the son, he magically appears out of the heavens, and the Jewish mother goes, he had a hat!
Actually, you told the joke, this was for Orthodox Jews.
So you told it through a hole in the sheet.
He had a black hat with a ring turned up.
They love when you make it. Oh, who's this guy? Meyer Kahani? They love that kind of stuff.
Andy, we should do a temple show together.
I would do it. And I'll tell you something, Joe. They're either the greatest experiences in the world or they are the worst experiences in the world.
Oh, I've done a bunch.
Jews don't. Oh, you have?
Yeah, yeah. I've got a couple things. I open with asking if I'm the only Gentile there, and then I ask if I'm there as a Shabbos goy, and they get excited. They're like, "How does he know that?" And then I make fun of Reform Jews. Oh no, not Reform, Reconstructionist Jews, because I said, because no one likes Reconstructionist Jews, and I said I knew someone was different with them when we all went up to receive communion. And that's the big laugh. And then after that, it's gold. Smooth sailing for the next 43 minutes.
When somebody heckles me at a temple, I say, this is not a Reconstructionist temple. I work alone. don't they get up and do the... Aren't they the rabbi?
Let me tell you something. My friend, Stan Schachter, where are you, Stan Schachter? He told me the funniest story. I think I told this, Dave. He told me that he says, Andy, I play a Jewish retirement home. Last week, and they told me, Stanley, don't go over a half hour because we're having sponge cake. And when they smell the sponge cake, the show is over.
Do Italians have sponge cake?
Well, I had a very similar experience to that. I did a show at a 55 and older community, which was generous in describing them. The people were in their 80s, and the producer of the show said, "Well, we've never had just comedy nights." She said, so tonight we're having comedians and it's cheesecake night. So she said, so anything could happen. I guess, I think it's because they get so fussy. The cheesecake
That's true.
Night.
Well, we're going to wrap it up. Andy Kindler, I love you.
I love you too.
This is, by the way, It was Joe DeVito. That was a surprise.
Oh, Joe DeVito. And I love you, Joe.
Thanks, Andy.
You're going to be on Thought Spiral, right?
Right.
I hear you're guesting on that with J. Elvis Weinstein?
Yes. He's my co-host, and look for it. We're good podcasts are sold.
Okay. Thank you.
I love you guys.
I love you too.
Have a good weekend. Okay. Bye-bye. Rock on.
Thank you.
Love you, Alex. Bye-bye.
All right.
What fun.
That was fun.
Oh, yeah. Andy still cracks me up. He's out of his mind.
Yeah. Yeah. So we're going to wrap it up. Before we say goodbye, how's life?
Things are pretty good.
How's the dating?
We replied to a woman on Plenty of Fish. She asked me what I did for a living, and I said, I'm a stand-up comic, and I also teach and write. And she replied and said, oh, that sounds really challenging, but what's your day job?
Oh.
And I said, I gave you three things that you could choose.
You teach?
I teach stand-up for a comedy school here in the city.
Is it Manhattan Comedy School?
No, it's Laughing Buddha.
Oh, I've seen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's fun. It's fun. And
what do you tell young people starting out? What advice do you give them?
I tell them if you only remember two things, it's that the joke starts off this long, it needs to end up much shorter, and say the funny part last and stop talking.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do those two things, almost every joke improves. But I've been lucky that they don't usually give me the brand new people because I find that very stressful. So they usually people who've been kicking around for a while. They're a little bit, not too many nut jobs.
Right.
Because it's hard because sometimes you get people where you think, how am I going to get this guy ready for the graduation show? He doesn't get it.
What if you're a storyteller?
I'm actually taking a storytelling class that starts this week. A lot of times comics say, well, I'm a storyteller. It's like, no, you just have a bloated act that you're too lazy to. Just because you have 90 seconds between punchlines and three quarters of the way through, you pause and look upstage and say, and that's when I realized. That doesn't mean you're a storyteller. It means you're a shitty comic.
You are so funny. Thank you, Joe.
My pleasure.
You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.